Our next speaker will be Mr. Robert Spencer. Mr. Robert Spencer is the US-based director of Jihad Watch, a program of the David Horowitz Freedom Center, and author of 13 books on Islam, including two New York Times bestsellers. He has led seminars on Islam and Jihad for the United States Central Command, the United States Army Command, and General Staff College, the US Army's asymmetric warfare group, the FBI, the Joint Terrorism Task Force, and the US Intelligence Community. He's a weekly columnist for PJ Media and Front Page magazine, and has written 11 monographs and well over 300 articles. Please put your hands together for Mr. Robert Spencer. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I wanted to call your attention to a couple of anniversaries, one that just passed recently and one that's coming up. The one that just passed was February 14th, the 25th anniversary of the Salman Rushdie death fatwa issued by the Islamic Republic of Iran. And then coming up on April 15th is the first anniversary of the Boston Marathon Jihad bombings. Now, these anniversaries are obviously related, but they are related, I think, in many important ways that it is key for us to understand and to bear in mind, because they are two prongs of the attack that we face today. One is, of course, jihad violence and mass murder, which happens on a more and more frequent basis every day somewhere around the world. The other is the prohibition on speaking honestly about its cause, which advances further all the time in Australia, in the United States, in Europe, and in the rest of the world. These two things go closely together. They go hand in hand, they are self-reinforcing, and they are part of the same overall attack. After the Salman Rushdie fatwa, those of you who may recall those days will remember that there was a tremendous international discussion and debate about the nature and parameters of the freedom of speech. And almost universally in the West, on the left as well as on the right, there were stout defenses of the freedom of speech as a bulwark, an absolute indispensable pillar of a free society, and thus something that was not negotiable. And there was general revulsion against the fatwa on Rushdie as something that was inimical to a free society, inimical to the principles of freedom of expression, and to the dignity of the human person. I recall in those days, I went to see a concert of the band 10,000 Maniacs. You remember them? And there's a fan. And Natalie Merchant, I believe, is the name of the singer. And they had a popular cover of Cat Stevens' song, Peace Train. Cat Stevens, in the meantime, of course, had become a Muslim, changed his name to Yusuf Islam, and had endorsed the Rushdie fatwa, saying on the BBC, when asked if he were dining in a restaurant and Salman Rushdie were at the next table, and an attacker came in, would he protect Rushdie? And he said, not only would I not protect him, I'd ring up the Ayatollah Khomeini and say, he's right here, and I'll hold him till you get somebody here. And so Natalie Merchant, knowing all that, and hearing the cries from the crowd saying, sing Peace Train, Peace Train, she said, no, as long as now that Cat Stevens has gone mad, I will never sing this song again. Now, fast forward 25 years later, just recently, Katy Perry, who you may know is a contemporary singer, I kind of wish I didn't, but nonetheless, she came out with a music video featuring, for a second or two, a man wearing a pendant that had the name of Allah written in Arabic on it. And then the man is burned to death. When a petition was started and 50,000 Muslims around the world signed it, demanding that Katy Perry take this video down and apologize, she immediately complied and erased the Allah pendant from the video. The descent from Natalie Merchant to Katy Perry is very steep. and it is indicative of what we are up against. Because what has happened in the 25 years since the Rushdie Fatwa, after all that indignation in defense of free speech in 1989, is the total collapse of a general understanding of the necessity of free speech and a general acceptance of the idea that if Muslims are offended about something, then we better stop doing it. Instead of reinforcing the ideas of a pluralistic society and say, you know, in a society where there are people with different perspectives, different values, different priorities, there are times when we're going to offend each other and we're just going to have to take that and live in peace. That idea is out the window. And instead, if something offends Muslims, then it has to go. And this, of course, happens at the highest levels and brings back to the connection with the Boston Marathon bombing and the April 15th anniversary. Several years before the Boston Marathon jihad bombing, as actually it was just read to you from this podium a few minutes ago, I used to rather regularly give training seminars to FBI agents, to Joint Terrorism Task Force, to various US military groups, and on occasion to the CIA. And then, in 2010, after protests from the Council on American Islamic Relations, which you may know is a Hamas-linked Muslim Brotherhood front group in the United States, the FBI and all the other agencies dropped me and others like me as trainers for agents and scrubbed all counterterrorism training materials of any mention of Islam and jihad. This was after, this culminated actually in 2011 in a letter from a Muslim lawyer named Farhana Khaira, who wrote a letter on behalf of 57 Muslim organizations in the United States demanding that all counterterror training materials and all counterterror training never mention Islam and have nothing to do with Islam or jihad, even though that's obviously the primary terror threat that we face. The letter was addressed to John Brennan, who was then a very high national security official in Barack Obama's administration and is now the director of the CIA. Brennan immediately complied in a letter written a few days later on White House stationery, as if to underscore that this was coming straight from the top. And Brennan said, yes, of course, we will eliminate all of this, and there will be no mention of Islam and jihad and this material that you find offensive, it will all be gone. And they did. Not long after that, Russian intelligence agents contacted the FBI, and they said that there was a man named Tamerlan Tsarnaev who was meeting with jihad terrorists in Chechnya and Dagestan, and that he lived in Boston, and they better keep an eye on him. And they warned more than once. And the FBI took a look at Tamerlan Tsarnaev and decided he was not a priority and not a threat. And he, of course, was one of the two, along with his brother, Boston Marathon mass murderers last year in the name of jihad. Why did the FBI not take the Russian warnings to heart? Why did the FBI not act on them? Probably because, in large part, they're not allowed to. They can't talk about this. The Russians said, Tamerlan Tsarnaev is meeting with jihadis. Well, what's a jihadi? According to the FBI, jihad is an interior spiritual struggle for the betterment of the human person. So they probably thought, well, how nice. And any agents who were there who knew what jihad was because they remembered from the training that had been scrubbed, although Brennan did say that every agent that got trained by me and by others like me would be re-educated. Chairman Mao would have been so pleased. And any of them that did remember, they were probably not able to act. Not long before all this happened, there was, of course, the Fort Hood jihad massacre in Texas on a military base where Major Nidal Malik Hassan, a U.S. Army psychiatrist, murdered 13 Americans while screaming Allahu Akbar, and after having handed out Qurans the morning of the shooting and saying he was about to do something great for Allah. And that, of course, has been classified by the Obama administration as a case of workplace violence. I wish it were a joke, but it's true. Now, Major Nidal Malik Hassan was a major in the U.S. Army, and he had just recently been promoted. And yet, a year or two before his attack, he gave grand rounds, which is when the psychiatrists, the Army psychiatrists, all get together, and one of them gives a lecture to the others about new breakthroughs, new discoveries, new advances in the field. Nidal Hassan, it came to be his turn, and he gave a presentation about jihad, terrifying his colleagues and raising the concerns of many of them that came out later, saying, we thought he was going to be violent and shoot people. And sure enough, they turned out to be right. What did the Army do? They gave him a promotion. And they gave him a promotion with top flight, top notch, top level recommendations, saying he's performing excellently, and we think that Army officers can benefit from his insights into Islam. Now, were these people absolute idiots? Were they fools? No. They were people like you and me who wanted to keep their jobs. And they knew what would have happened if they had reported Nidal Malik Hassan and said, this guy is preaching jihad violence when he's supposed to be training psychiatrists. This guy is clearly somebody who is a great potential danger. And not only that, of course, later it came out he was in touch with Anwar al-Awlaki, the jihad leader, and there were all sorts of other danger signs. But they knew that they couldn't do that. They knew they couldn't report him. Because you can then imagine what would have happened next. The New York Times would have had a story about Islamophobia in the military and Muslim soldiers being hounded just for expressing their faith. And the people who had been responsible for the negative recommendations, you know what would have happened to them. They would have lost their jobs. They would have been publicly humiliated. They would have been raked over the coals on CNN and in Time magazine and in the New York Times and Washington Post as racist, bigoted Islamophobes. And they would have been lucky to be able to get a job at a McDonald's after that. Because McDonald's doesn't want to hire racists any more than anybody else. So look, this denial, this refusal to accept the reality of what we're facing, this inability to discuss it rationally, honestly, and fully, it's murderous, it kills, it takes lives. We saw it in Fort Hood, and we saw it in Boston. And it's a direct result of something that started rolling at the time of the Rushdie Fatwa. The Rushdie Fatwa was an assault on the Western notions of freedom of speech. And at that time, people knew still that freedom of speech was valuable. But as they kept pushing and kept on relentlessly pressing against it, and the Organization of Islamic Cooperation launched its worldwide effort to compel Western nations to criminalize criticism of Islam under the guise of so-called hate speech, our understanding of the freedom of speech is eroded, and we have, without even realizing it, internalized these Sharia blasphemy provisions that there's something wrong with speaking critically about Islam and jihad and Islamic supremacism and Islamic terrorism. And the result is that 13 people are dead at Fort Hood, 3 people dead in Boston, hundreds wounded and maimed. All because we cannot speak about this. And we know what will happen when we speak about it. And I know because I've spoken to many of you over the last few days and encouraged you to speak out yourselves. And you say, well, you know, I have a job, I'll lose my position. They would call me a bigot and a racist. Well, of course, and you know why? Because they know that that's what works. That's what they will say that will keep us from being able to do anything but stand mute and defenseless in the face of this ongoing threat. It is absolutely imperative that we recall the words of the American Declaration of Independence, that the 56 signers, at the end of the document, they say, to this great cause, they say, we pledge our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor. Our sacred honor, you know, we don't talk like that now in the 21st century. You know, we don't say, you know, my honor is offended. We only actually hear about that in Islamic contexts with honor killings and things like that. But actually, our sacred honor is what they're assaulting most effectively. Because we all know, and many, many people outside this room know full well, that to speak honestly about jihad violence means they will destroy you as a person. They will make you somebody that nobody wants to have anything to do with. Somebody where, if you Google the name, all these things, these terrible things come up. Most people don't want to risk it, but if we don't, then the jihad will continue to advance. It's just that simple. If we don't take the risk and allow our lives and fortunes and sacred honor to be put at risk, then our children and our grandchildren, their lives and their fortunes and their sacred honor will be drastically and irrevocably diminished. The Islamic jihad agenda is for a purpose. It is to make Islamic law the law of the land. Islamic law is a very, very detailed complex of laws that mandates the discrimination against and second-class status of women and non-Muslims and others. It is a law that if you criticize it, then you immediately forfeit your right to live. It is, in other words, a totalitarian system, a slow-motion reign of terror, no less unmistakably a reign of terror than the reigns of terror that we saw from the Bolsheviks, from the Maoists, from Pol Pot. It is no less a reign of terror. It's just one that is less dramatic and one that is more codified. You know that if you step out of line, that if you do certain things, you will be stoned to death. If you do other things, you'll be beheaded. If you do other things, your hand will be amputated. In the Judeo-Christian tradition, there is the idea of the cultivation of virtue and the development of the character of the human being so that you choose what is good and reject what is not good, what is evil, because it is evil, because you prefer the good to the evil. The virtue that is inculcated by stoning, by amputation, by beheading, by those kinds of threats, that's not virtue. That is an empire of fear. That is living your life too afraid to step out of line, because you know what would await you if you do. That empire of fear is the society that our children and grandchildren will grow up in and live and die in, as millions of Jews and Christians and other non-Muslims have done in the 14 centuries that Islam has existed. That is what we have to look forward to. Of course they are going to be fighting. Of course they are going to make it difficult for us. The more of us who stand up, the less likely they will be able to succeed. I still believe, in order to end on a happy note, that human nature will never willingly accept slavery, and that we will not go gently into the night. And I can tell you one last story about another thwarted jihad attack in the United States at Fort Dix. There was a group of Muslims, six Muslims, who were going to go into Fort Dix and shoot as many American soldiers as possible before they themselves were killed, and then of course they'd go and enjoy the virgins in paradise. The plot was thwarted because they liked to watch jihad movies, beheadings, shootings, that kind of thing, bloody stuff. And the problem was they had them on VHS tapes. So they took them to the DVD store and asked that they be transferred to DVD. This is a true story. So there was a 17-year-old kid in the DVD store, this clerk, and he's transferring these tapes from VHS to DVD, and he's seeing all this blood and gore and hate and violence go by. And he realizes, you know, these guys might be up to something. So he went to his manager and he said, "Dude, I'm seeing some really weird things on these videos. Should I go to the police, or would that be racist?" And you see, that sums up everything I'm telling you today. The fact that the guy even thought for a minute, "That's racist," shows how insane we have all let ourselves become and how insane the society has become. That he would hesitate for a minute when he sees jihad, mass murder, and bloodshed. And he hesitates because he knows already, he's internalized the lesson that the Islamic Republic of Iran wanted to give us all with the Rushdie Fatwa. To oppose us is racist, it's hateful, it's bigoted. And he's grown up with it, he's breathed it in, it's the air he lives with. So, The great news is, he decided to go ahead and be racist. He turned them in, and they're in prison now. The better angels of his nature won out. And I have every confidence. I know that I'm preaching to the converted in this room, because I know you're already energized enough to be here. But I encourage you to take the next step. And next time I'm here, next year, or 2 or 3 years, I hope to come back and we'll have a Q Society meeting with all that part filled up and people standing outside for much more, and that we will begin to make a difference in Australian politics as well as in American politics, and to turn this around. Human beings are made not to be slaves, but to be free, and this is the great struggle between freedom and slavery. And the thing about slavery is, it's easy. Everything's set out for you. You know exactly what you have to do. You don't have to take any responsibility. You don't have to make any decisions. You just have to do what you're told. Let's be better than that. Thank you.